Alright, hello and welcome everyone here to some Join Dota League Season 3 America's action. It's really South America action, as we've got the Peruvian squad, Union Gaming, going up against the Houses Down, which I still believe they're a Brazilian organization, so should be fun. Two game series as always here in the Join Dota League. I'm Helium, and co-casting with me is a friend and also a pretty good player, Static from Armada Gaming.
Hi. So yeah, this should be an interesting matchup.
Yeah, I haven't actually seen the Houses Down in a long time.
Yeah, they've been grinding the joinDOTA League, I guess, to get back in the Premier League, but they're a Brazilian team.
All right, good to know. And unfortunately, I learned in the lobby that one of the players I liked on their team is now playing another game that we love so much around here in the Dota 2 community. So I'm sad to hear that. Hopefully he'll come back. But we see a Doom banned out. Nothing too surprising. Doom, pretty annoying. Saw a lot of bans from him earlier today when I was casting in the European Premier Division. Like, and also had a pick and a ban in those two games. I don't know if you've got any amazing thoughts on those two heroes, but
I mean, it's a pretty standard ban so far. There's Doom, it's just well-rounded to fit in any lineup, and no one wants to play against a Lycan, especially against I guess South American Dota. They like to play those red Dota a lot, pushing strats, pulling up, stuff like that.
Yes, them and everybody, including all pubs, unfortunately, these days. There's quite a bit of the five-man death ball in the early rat Dota from, I guess, Lycan is really the only hero that can really split push super early on. I was going to say Death Prophet's probably the other one, so she's also going to get banned out. Union Gaming's generally a team that likes to fight and be in your face right away, so we'll look for them to obviously draft similar to that. And I guess the meta kind of shifted into... That was already their style, and the meta kind of shifted into their style, which is, I guess, different than what normally happens, where you have to find the meta, but I don't know. Fortunate for them, we'll see how it works.
Yeah, they might be a step ahead of everyone. I mean, TI was pretty much all around the dead ball pushing, and then I guess we're going to see some more tonight.
Probably. Pretty long first banning phase. I would say Void, Razor, or Skywrath, or okay, I was getting there. Or Brewmaster, probably going to be the next bans, and probably see some of those heroes taken out in the second phase, but now it's Union Gaming. First pick, what do you think it is? Oh, too late. Their picks, what do you think they are?
They're going to pick Skywrath Mage.
I would say Skywrath and Void, like almost 100%. Sorry for typing. I didn't think this game was going to happen, so I didn't prepare my tweets beforehand.
Yeah, same thing.
Union Gaming versus the House is Down. You'd think... Oh, nice. House is Down, I remember. I told them to make a Twitter, and they actually did. You think... 5 seconds. All these teams would have Twitters, right? Because that's like the best way to get their names out there.
Yeah, Twitter is mainly strong in the United States, but I don't think it's as strong in South America.
Yeah, and Europe, I guess. It's not as big of a deal, right, though? Because you're trying to appeal to a global audience. It doesn't matter where you are. You can just sit down and watch Twitch anywhere. Or do ya?
So they went for Tide. They went for Tide and Viper, which are not so usual first pick. Tide is played a lot, but he's not usually first pick. So that means they're probably gonna fight early because they have those two heroes that have big potential for elite team fights.
Yeah, they're both green, so that's my contribution. And everyone on Unigaming is blue.
Does that mean we're gonna see a Nature Prophet?
That's always good. We gotta get a Nature's Prophet and a Treant, and then Union Gaming has to pick Zeus and
Faceless Void. Kind of,
yeah, I guess he's sort of blue. I feel like purple could go on either of these teams pretty nicely.
He has some bluish colors.
Yeah, purple's complementary to green, so it would look nice at least.
So, you need Venomancer too?
Yeah, Venomancer would work. He's a lighter green. Viper's better, I think. Probably why Venomancer. Although, I don't know, Vici Gaming played Venomancer a lot in the farming role. Just get that early mech, your agility, you've got high armor to start with, and obviously you can push and defend like a boss with those plague wards, but I don't know, obviously it didn't work out. It won them a couple million, it didn't win them 5 million.
Huh. That's interesting. Ban a Morphling.
Maybe just because of the Viper pick second. Like you said, it's unusual to pick Viper second, and that Morphling Viper interaction is interesting, so maybe the House of Zaun wanted to have them both, as opposed to, you know, maybe Union Gaming picks. I don't know, actually. I feel I'm trying like to rationalize this, but none of it really matters.
Disruptor's pretty good against Morphling, so I don't know. I think they already had the tools to deal with it, but maybe they really don't like playing against it.
Yeah, that's probably it. Sand King banned out, though. I know, I don't know, the roster switch up a little bit, but I'm pretty sure it's Jericho, who is really, really good, or maybe it's Xander Steel, who's really good at that Sand King. Obviously a good hero, can get that Blink Dagger up pretty quickly with the jungling, with the Sandstorm, but really powerful in the hands of some of these players, especially Xander. I think that's who it is.
Who do you think is going to be the next pick?
I don't know. I'm really surprised. Well, Skywrath got banned. I'm really surprised Void hasn't been picked on either side yet. Maybe Union Gaming go for it now. Shadow Shaman seemed to be a shoe-in to get picked eventually because, you know, he just pocket push basically on your team. If you don't have it, just pick Shadow Shaman and then suddenly you can push after you win team fights. Maybe Enigma as well, kind of the same role.
I feel like Pugna's gonna come. He's gonna show his face on the Radiant side.
He is green, so...
He's green and he takes towers that would fit with the Shadow Shaman. And if they get those two heroes, the pushing become really, really strong.
Yeah, that would be true. And I see the Sand King band, who is a support that kind of just disappears into the jungle anyways, except for maybe like a one or two rotations early on. Maybe more if they're really successful. And continue to be, but you could honestly just pick up an Enigma, disappear into the jungle, and get those big items, maybe a mech into a Blink or mech BKB on an Enigma, as opposed to your Sand King. It's almost the same thing. I mean, Epicenter does a little bit more damage, but you really just want the disable of the Burrow Strikes with that Blink Dagger. Epicenter is, I guess, an added bonus, but they will go with an Enchantress. Same token, she's just going to sort of be in the jungle, and she can rotate maybe a little more efficiently than an Enigma would.
This is quite interesting. They're not two usual picks, so it should be a pretty fun game to watch.
Yeah, it'll be nice. Sorry, I'm still trying to finish up some things to get everything added where it should be.
We're going to have the game set up properly by the end of the draft.
5 seconds. Yeah, we'll be there. That's what happens. Like I had set up everything for this stream, and then I was like, wow, this game's not going to happen. It's 8:30 on the East Coast of America, so I was like, all right, I guess I'm gonna set up my own stream. So I like just undid everything, and then I see the lobby's hosted, so I had to go redo it all. But Earthshaker picked up. I really am liking, it's kind of annoying to play against, but it's really fun to watch, the Earthshaker Skywrath combination as supports.
It's so scary against an Enchantress.
It's insane.
If they get their hands on another big AoE, you get the Tidehunter with the Earthshaker ult. It's really scary for the Dire side right now.
And even Aethershock hitting up to what, 7 targets when it's maxed out for 320? That's a lot of magic damage.
Another big AoE.
Gets off to a good start. And well, the offlaner's already chosen.
Centaur's a really good pick, I think, for them right now, because they need some big teamfight presence, and he's the one that's going to stand in front of the Razor, allowing him to blow people up. 10 seconds
remaining. Yeah, he also will provide an escape from the Viper, who is generally just chases people around or kites them around. But now, if they need to get out of something or need to initiate once they're already slowed, they can just throw the Stampede, and you've got the best move speed you could ever want or ever get, unless you're Bloodseeker. So that should be nice for initiation. He should also be going for a Blink Dagger, so maybe he can look to pick off the Earthshaker or the Shadow Shaman before they jump in with an Echo or jump in with a Hex Shackle or something like that.
Who do you think is going to start pushing first? They have an Enchantress, which usually...
Well, I think Enchantress will want to start pushing early, but you got to be careful, right? Like, if you can zone the Tidehunter and make sure he's staying level 1 or level 2 for a while, then that's probably better than, say, pushing into his tower and then letting him open up the lane to let him get level 6. So maybe they choose not to push, although I think Union Gaming could start pushing earlier. That being said, I'm thinking the house is down. Like, if Shadow Shaman gets off to a good start and he's got the wards, you're just going to push, like, mm-hmm. straight up. It just depends if Union Gaming pushes before the time that most of the supports are level 6. That kind of answers the question indirectly.
Yeah, but those two, Earthshaker and Shadow Shaman, requires a lot of levels in order to work properly. So they're going to have to get a pretty good start.
Well, Earthshaker really only needs level 2, but Shadow Shaman definitely needs some big levels.
I mean,
at least for the
Anything in the game, I guess. When he gets those items, he's really kicking off before he's just a good counter initiate.
Yeah, well, yeah, this is also really good at just stopping rotations, right? Like, Enchantress comes to the mid lane with a couple of creep, it's nighttime, you know, maybe it's 4 minutes. We'll just go with 4 minutes, 20 seconds, random number. Earthshaker just comes in, throws down a Fissure, and then pretty much the gank is over, assuming he doesn't screw it up completely. And wow, Meepo comes out fifth. And this is actually the second South American team I've seen pick up Meepo. Revenge, which is actually a new roster, because the Revenge most people know is now Not Today. But they played it, and they did fantastic with it. They also ran it middle while having a Viper on their squad. They ran Meepo middle against a Viper. So I'm interested to see where Meepo's going to go.
Don't you think it's a little bit cocky picking a Meepo into a Disruptor? Disruptor is pretty cocky, in my opinion.
Yeah, I would agree, but if you're pretty good at Meepo and you can farm in the lane, get that XP, if once you get a Blink Dagger, like, just blink on Disruptor and he dies literally instantly, so...
Yeah, that's true.
I don't know. It depends who sort of has the momentum going into the mid-game. Like, if Union Gaming are getting the kills and the pickoffs, it'll probably be hard for Meepo, but if it's the house is down sort of dictating the pace of the game, then I think Meepo can probably just run over him. And Spectre is the last pick here for Union. It's a great hero, and it can carry as hard as most heroes, but I don't know, man. Meepo is probably the scariest late-game hero.
If I'm watching right now, I can see that the THD has a lot more damage burst. So early on, if they take fights around 10-minute mark, I think they're going to have a big advantage. Otherwise, late-game Union heroes are scaling a bit better. So I think they're going to want to take this really late game.
Good old South American Doto. We'll probably be paused for a while. Actually, one of THD's members has already come back. You don't have a personal Twitter, right? Should I just put
Yeah,
a lot of gaming on
I'm
the overlay?
I'm using Static Doto right now. I'm not tweeting too much, but I'm getting used to it. So I have to run two Twitter accounts, but I have to do mine too.
I do not envy you.
It's fun though, because I can retweet myself.
Oh, yeah, that's actually kind of cheating, because Armada Gaming should have a pretty good following.
It's not too bad. We have a better following on Facebook, but our Twitter's getting there. It's only 215.
Oh, I got more than you, bro.
Yeah, but our Facebook page is like 5,000 or something.
Yeah, you got me beat there.
So we're slowly kicking off on Twitter, as we're Canadians, and Canadians are not Twitter guys.
That's probably good. What's bigger for you guys, Dota 2 or CSGO?
I'd say CSGO and League of Legends. Because Dota right now, we currently don't have a fixed lineup. We're like using players for different leagues, and we're having decent success doing it, but... if we could have a stable roster, it would be better, obviously.
Yeah, it turns out those stable rosters are pretty hard to come by unless you're actually winning a lot of tournaments.
Yes, especially in the semi-pro scene, people usually find out the weakling in the team and they tend to disband. But you need to stick together if you want to make it.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's such a mistake that a lot of teams make. Almost every team makes, like...
They make
all these
one
teams
step
have fallen
forward
victim to it, like,
3 step backward every time they change someone from the team.
I think Ben has jumped. The Spectre player this game has jumped from like 3 different South American teams in like the last couple months.
Well, what team was he on before?
I know he's been a part of Union Gaming, but I think he also was on Revenge for a while, because there was a whole thing about Iwo and Ben Haas wanted to play together or something like that. I remember a bit of the drama during the TI qualifiers, but
yeah, I remember
not
that.
The specifics.
So
this roster's been pretty stable for a while.
He did not end up playing TI qualifiers, right?
No, they had to play for the teams that they were on currently, so they were split up, because Valve wouldn't let anyone change, even at the qualifier level.
Mm-hmm.
Which is smart for them, obviously.
Yeah, because anyone could change. I think at some point you gotta stick together, and Valve understands that. They don't wanna just throw out a professional player into the qualifiers out of nowhere, I guess.
Yeah, and Valve obviously passed the test. I mean, the hardest issue is probably with Fnatic, like a fan-favorite team that can bring money and views, and they kind of saw that the Excalibur Switch was, you know, it maybe had legit reasons, but maybe didn't, and it was pretty controversial, I suppose, but I think they made the right decision.
Yeah, they made the right decision because the player actually didn't want to get changed. The organization wanted to change him, but the player was not willing to, so Valve just listened to the player since he got his team qualified for TI.
Indeed, and looks like we're still waiting on Ben Haas here. We need to just move all these guys to, like, America so their internet works. Not that our internet service providers are that much better, but they're
more stable,
better.
I guess.
They're probably just as corrupt, but they work better. Those ISPs. I guess I shouldn't flame them while I'm using the internet. Or internet service providers.
There was some action on the Skype group before the game about the South American teams.
Alright, well, we're still paused. Oh, he's back. Nice. I always do that. I'm like, alright, well, we're still... Oh, we're going. Didn't you say both games US East? Yes, that was agreed upon. It was both games US East unless both teams agreed on something else, which is usually not the case because it requires people to talk to each other.
I don't think this is US East, unless I'm mistaken.
I can check.
Yeah, that's not. I have 200 ping.
Yeah, I've got 235. I'm actually pretty good. I could probably play on South American servers because I live in the bottom southern Florida, so like all the routing that goes to South America goes from here.
230 is really, is awful in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, I draw the line at like 180.
Oh yeah, 180 is okay to play, I guess. But
I'd play a support or something.
Yeah,
or like Tide Hunter, you don't gotta do anything on that hero. He's broken and easy.
Yeah, you just press R, everyone dies.
R, E. Alright, team is half HP and they don't have any damage. GG.
And they can't kill you because you're like unkillable.
Yeah, exactly. Silence. Nope, still gets Ravager off because Kraken Shell. It's actually ridiculous. What do you think? I saw it earlier and obviously I've seen it before. Tidehunter and Rubick together. Like, you land an Anchor Smash and a Fade Bolt against a team that has any sort of right click, and they literally can't do any damage.
Yeah, I saw this combo quite a lot, but they were running it with the tight support. I think the battle begins. When you lift the guy up and you bring him back, then Gush, it's also really good going along with the reduced damage combo, so I think it's a pretty decent support duo.
Yeah, I like it. I don't think Rubick was banned, and we're going to have another disconnect.
Alright,
well, the lanes are pretty much revealed now, so we can go over anything sticking out to you in terms of the laning or any interesting matchups?
I think Centaur against Viper is could go either way. I guess Viper has an advantage, but Centaur can still do fine in this lane. Top is interesting because they're hiding right now with Earthshaker, so they might be able to trap someone with the Fisher if someone's not efficient and he go on the side over there, he can trap him like that. And then they get an easy first blood because the Shackle and the last forever. They're
yes,
running. Who's farming top? Is it Tide?
We'll probably have to check out the items there. Oh, you mean on the Radiant side? Yeah, I would assume Tide. He's got... I don't think these supports are staying here. I think they're actually just looking for a cheap first blood, which actually this pause could be really bad because it is only a 2-minute delay. They pause, they look at the stream, they're like, hmm.
I really feel like they should stay top because Viper's going to be all fine against the Tide. And those guys can shut down Spectre farm so much since they have Enchantress jungle. So I guess we're going to see a Tide with some early Blink Dagger.
Yeah, lots of Tangos pulled. Tide bought two sets of his own, so
this
eight, and then
so
got
dead.
One from Bestius.
This Disruptor is going to die. No, never mind.
Think so?
Being careful.
They get revealed, the Spectral Dagger. Now they're slowed on the move speed. They're trying to block off Jericho here, but he's pretty far away, and... Well, the first blood attempt, the cheesy first blood attempt, I'll call it that. Although, I do that a lot. If you want to gain MMR, like, just set up like that at the start of every game, and then you get first blood, and the other team's like, GG, we lost.
There's no way in pub games that people will expect that and position
themselves. Yeah, I know.
Like
it works 100% of the time if you queue with three people. But mid lane, we've got Razor versus Meepo. Razor has a bit of damage when he does zap it away. Once Static Link is level 2, it actually amounts to quite a bit. More so at higher levels. But
Enchantress with the DD ganking bottom.
Ooh. That's but Meepo will also have two Meepos, so the other one won't be losing its damage. And it looks like Xander will just use that double damage on the Enchantress to just jungle faster for now.
Yeah. Ganking coming middle too, with the smoke.
Nice, I like that you're going to utilize this Fisher early on. The net goes out, and there's the Fisher block, so this should be the first blood. He's actually just going to go and run down. No points in Unstable Current yet. And that's going to be it. Gooey's just a little too slow here on the Shadow Shaman, so...
He was so close for that Shackle
only
Wrench.
Only
going to
get harder. As he's got enough for boots now. Razor, not one to really go for a bottle, but we'll see if he wants to. He's got 630 gold, so I'm starting to think he will be buying one.
Do you know about that matchup? How does Meepo do against Razor? I feel like he's going to have some trouble there.
I would think pretty good, like... Because he's got another Meepo now, right? So even if he does get harassed down, he could just send one Meepo back and do like a poof poof TP to be back to full HP without ever losing XP, and there is a first blood. I don't even care.
I haven't seen it.
That we missed it. It was in the bottom lane. It was that rotation that didn't work in the mid lane comes down and will kill the Enchantress. So Gooey and Bestius, who is a returning member of THD, I know for sure, rotate down and they will kill the Enchantress played by Xander, who now goes back to his own jungle. A little too scared now to stay down there that the sports have rotated. And I figured they would, but like what you said, I don't think it was a bad idea either if they just stay top and shut down the Spectre.
The Spectre's gonna... He's actually only have 8 creep kills, so I don't know what's going on up there, but...
Melee
looks
versus
like,
Tide.
Tide is giving him some hard time.
Well, yeah, it is just a support disruptor who can't do too much. There's soon to be 2 points in Kraken Shell, so you actually won't even take damage from Disruptor, who's already used most of his mana on either a Glimpse or a Thunderstrike. As soon as Tide gets close to Spectre, he Anchor Smashes, and then she already has extremely low base damage. A little more because she goes for a Poor Man Shield off the start, but it's going to be reduced down to like 40 after one Anchor Smash. So that makes it pretty hard to get those last hits.
Just a second, someone's spamming me.
Yeah, no worries. And Meepo got a bottle, which I feel like is interesting. I feel like that's a Meepo item, because there's so many Meepos that you gotta bottle them all. It seems pretty inefficient, but maybe just to sustain a little more against Citadel here on the Razor. And it is Citadel on the Razor, extremely high skill mid player. I'm not so sure about Toy.
So we've got another pause here. Is it for
Lasso is so annoying.
A lagging or something? No one's DC'd yet? Razor's not going any point in Unstable Current. I think that's pretty good against Meepo, but looks
yeah,
like his build's working
out.
So far.
I would agree that Immortal is pretty hilarious, that sound. The inscribed Severing Crest that does it. I did also receive that Immortal. It's like the only one I didn't want out of the chest. But I got the Spectre one, which is apparently like really rare. It's also really badass.
I haven't seen it. What does it look like?
It's like a massive white Reaper's Scythe. It looks really... And Yuka, or... I'm guessing his name is spelled backwards with a capital letter at the end of it? I don't know. I guess that's pretty standard. Yuka and the Titan are in some trouble after the glimpse now. Running through all that black trail of, I don't even know what that spell's called. Spectral Dagger Trail. So obviously getting his move speed reduced, Spectre's increased, and Disruptor's gonna get the kill. Meanwhile, Meepo did manage to kill the Razor in the middle lane again with the help of Tide. Not Tide. Earthshaker.
Wow.
And his Fisher picking up that kill.
I was unfortunate for the Tide, he got blocked by his own creeps in the trees.
Yeah.
I don't know how the Meepo got a kill on the Razor, but I guess he really should have taken that.
Geostrike? 7 damage?
Yeah, but if he gets the unstable current, he can't really die because Meepo's going to be slowed so much.
I'm not sure. So far, we missed THD, it. We were looking top.
THD's coming ahead from this laning phase.
Yeah, in terms of farm, it's their Viper who is in first place, 32-11. That Centaur matchup in that lane is 6-0 on his last hit. So lane is hard. He is getting a lot of experience, so it's 5.5 minutes in. He's already level 5. He does have Tranquil Boots up. Probably going to look for that quick Blink Dagger. Maybe he decides to go for a Cloak or something just to get some magic resistance out. We'll have to wait and see. Tidehunter, 18-4 compared to Spectre, 21-4. So that lane's relatively even, but considering it's 1 versus 2, Tide's doing really well. And then middle lane, 26-13 for the Razor, and 21-1, so again, pretty close there. Razor with a slight edge.
So far, the Enchantress pick is not paying off so much because she's losing her creeps. She got ganked. She needs to make some stuff happen around the map. I think her allies need her, especially top, because the Tarantor is getting way too much out of that lane. It's basically a 1v3, but now they're letting the Spectre alone with a Tide, which could potentially kill him really soon if he gets level 6.
Yeah, he's very, very close. Only about 46, 47 experience away from that. He's level 6. He got another creep. I think he's going to go for it right here. Spectral Dagger was just used. No, just a little bit more harass. I mean, Enchantress can rotate over as long as she... There it is, the Dark Troll Summoner, because... Tide's the only ally up here, so Desolate damage is going to actually hurt a fair amount, because it is pure, right? Yeah, it's pure damage. An added bonus of, what, 50 right now? Yeah, at rank 3? So it's really strong. They just need a little bit of lockdown for the Tide, which is a hard thing to do because of Kraken Shell. And actually, mid lane, another gank attempt on Citadel Fisher. Nets to land. Toy coming in. Poof, poof, poof. Another net. Really nice micro here from Toy. That's why he picked the Meepo. And they bring down the Razor once more. Vestius on the Earthshaker. Picking up that one. He's level 4.
I feel like maybe they should rotate lanes, put the Razor bottom and the Centaur middle. Could be more effective. Both of them would probably farm more and not die.
Do you want me to read you an excerpt from Twitch chat about you?
Sure.
It's kind of a bad pun, I guess, but someone said,
I don't care.
I thought Static's mic had static, but it was just Static Link.
Yeah, I get those kind of joke pretty often.
So not the first time.
I had one for the first time, I think, yesterday. Someone said stat dick. I was like, okay, that's the first time I heard it.
Like that one. I think that one would have been abused already.
The Titan is just looking at those supports ferociously. He wants to get a kill with this big Ravage right now.
He does. Will he be able to do it, though? There is a glimpse available in that. Look at that Desolate damage! It's a lot! TP's coming in. He's going to try to kill Jericho here, but he should go down to the Desolate. Haunt goes out. Jericho will die to the Poison Strike. Don't even need to deal with him. And there's the Stampede. Global Stampede to get away.
Beautiful spell by Disruptor.
Oh, Courier, Courier. Enchant Totem Courier! Oh, not even close. He's going to have to hit like 8 times.
Yeah,
Enchant Totem
he'd
have to
checker.
Do twice, probably. Meanwhile, Enchantress... still farming. Level 5 right now. 8 minutes. Looking at her CS. 29 in the jungle. Doing pretty well. Does have an urn, so she knows she wants to be active and should be active. She's building for it, but so far she just can't get anything done. She was trying to kill Viper, then Viper just went top. Got a rebuttal kill there on the Disruptor. Now they're looking to push. Shadow Shaman with one extra person here. Maybe a creep wave, maybe two. He's level 6, and they're going to push down this tier 1 tower, I think.
That was really unfortunate for Enchantress. Her Dark Troll vanished at the same time as he was going to get a kill on Meepo.
Well, unfortunate for her, but very fortunate for Toy here on the Meepo, who is now level 9. He's got... obviously, Meepo gets a lot of experience because of the way his ultimate works. So he's level 9. Next highest is level 8 here on the Viper. They get caught up a little bit in that kinetic field, and the Fisher goes out. It is not blocking, and it works out perfectly because Lelis here on the Viper gonna be picking up the kill from that.
Once Dire is heading for the first tower middle, so maybe they're gonna win the bet.
Yeah, I really didn't think Enchantress was going to be able to do too much early, mainly for this reason that we're seeing right now. The Fisher into just being killed by, apparently, Meepo. The Meepo I didn't quite expect at the time.
They can punish her so hard with those heroes.
And then now level 6 on Shadow Shaman, so they should be the ones getting the first tower up here in the top lane. Half HP tier 1.
Yeah, they're going for it right now. I don't think they should fight this, they should just sack it, I guess. This Razor is going for an early mech, but it's not that early, so...
They're gonna need to... They got the tower.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I was just clicking on someone. Someone already has a mech. The Viper, of course, already has a mech, and Viper, Razor, pretty similar in those roles. Usually thought of as carries, I guess, in days past or pubs past, but now they just pick up those utility items really, really early on. It's usually phase mech or treads mech for them. And actually, it's even funnier because they also like to get drums and they also like to get ags as their next item. So their item builds are pretty much identical, but the heroes really nothing alike one another.
The gold graph is spinning really hard on the Radiant side right now. Oh, we're gonna see a kill on Viper. He's getting caught.
Are we though?
Pretty sure
he's we should.
Oh?
Gooey actually needs to get closer so the Desolate damage doesn't go off. He's actually going to throw out the mech. Lela's still alive right now. Razor going to rotate over from the middle lane, so he comes up here and he will get a kill for his effort. So Citadel picking off the Viper for 272 gold. Vestius was close with the Fisher, but not quite close enough. And now skipping over the terrain, Benha's looking for another kill. There's still a Fisher, and I think it's kind of buggy. Like, you... I don't think you'll go over the Fisher, will you?
Yeah, you will. If you have the Spectre Goo... on the Fisher, you can go over it.
Alright, I guess that will work. Maybe, because I was playing Broodmother, and like I couldn't go over Clockwork's Cogs, and it was driving me absolutely insane.
Oh, really? Do you get knocked out, or...?
No, well, it was Ally Cogs. Like, I couldn't get over them.
Okay.
And I don't know, maybe they had Vision on me, I'm not sure. Because that is a change they made to Broodmother, but it was kind of buggy. I wouldn't be super surprised if... The Desolate is pretty buggy, and Cogs actually, since they got changed,
this Razor is gonna die again.
Strange. Oh my gosh, I don't think the Serpent Wards were even remotely necessary, and that's almost a bit of a mistake, right? Like, you didn't need to use that, and that could have led to pushing the mid-tier 1 tower. Probably will anyways, because Meepo also destroys towers, but...
But they have the possibility to defend now that there's no wards.
Yeah.
They're really struggling right now on Dire side in order to get farm on the map. The Radiant's getting much more everywhere. So they're not going for the tower since they don't have the wards, but there's a big enchant stack coming up for the Tidehunter. With that, he's gonna be close to his Blink Dagger.
Yeah, and let's see his skill build right now. He goes 2-4. In terms of the Kraken Shell and the Anchor Smash. If you put 3 points in Kraken Shell and just 3 in Anchor Smash, you can still clear them really quickly, especially once you have mana boots and you take no damage. What I noticed quite a few of the pros doing was they'll be going for the mech first on Tidehunter, and they'll still have like a Tango at this point. And with the headdress component and eating a Tango, with 2 points in Kraken Shell, you also don't take... Well, you take damage, but you regen it all. So it's pretty stable. As, like, you can see he's getting pretty low, and he might actually not be able to kill out this last granite golem. Or even an ancient black dragon.
How many buffs are we gonna get in this?
You literally can't be surprised, man. You should have left while you could have. I'm gonna have to make a new rule about not casting South American Dota. Which is unfortunate, because like, they're really good, and they deserve to be cast.
Or you could make another rule that every time you cast a South American Dota and they pause, you need to take a shot or something.
Take a
like
shot
that.
Of Red Bull, of course.
No.
No, it's code, don't worry.
Come on.
Red Bull. I don't know.
People got back in him already. Yeah, he's going to be so dangerous. As you said, he can jump on this Disruptor pretty easily, which is only level 6. What else do we see on the map?
What team is Jolly Joker on your Armada squad? Or
yes.
Who does he play for now?
He's playing along with Fudzy, Monkeys Forever, Rolo, and Fun. And they're playing on their Armada for JDL.
I met some of them at TI4, actually.
Yeah, they're really nice guys.
And I play with Rolo and Fudzy from time to time, and they're the two I met up with at TI4. pretty good. Good times. They were sitting in the nosebleeds, though. I was like, I can't do this. I have to leave. It was so far away. Another pause.
At some point, maybe we'll be able to finish this game, but so far it's looking salty for the dire side.
Yeah, they like to be in a bit of trouble. There's a Blink Dagger on Centaur right now, and he could also maybe take down the Meepo pretty quick. He does have a lot of magical damage and double edge, but we can't forget about Meepo's built-in magic resistance, 35%. So there are a lot of Meepos, which can be pretty scary because you're a little vulnerable to magic damage, I guess, as Meepo. But because of that, to balance him out, I suppose, a bit higher magic resistance. But he could be in trouble right now unless he's poofing out. He's not. He poofs to his Meepos that were there together. Poof, not a very long cooldown, though, and I honestly don't think... because Desolate will never work on Meepo, essentially.
Wow, so they're not going to have that beautiful bonus nets? Damage. That's amazing.
Pretty good. I learned something the other day. If someone is already netted and they start TPing, refreshing the same net won't cancel it. You have to let it run out.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's pretty hard to time up.
Chicago Ted that informed me of that one. I had no idea. Still, I'm not convinced of his Meepo skills. I'll have to see for myself. Anyways, that's the one hero you don't want to glimpse. He gets up an Echo Slam onto two or three. He dies. It doesn't really get much for it. The Ravage goes out now. And lots of ultimates just being used defensively. Now Meepo going to come into the fight. Takes out the Spectre immediately. Citadel trying to TP back to base. He won't be able to make it. And now Toy with a double kill. Make it a triple. Nope, just a double. Lelis going to go ahead and grab that last kill on the Centaur. So they glimpse in the Earthshaker, who echoes immediately, which honestly wasn't that bad. Ravage, again, wasn't that great of a Ravage, but Meepo comes in and just cleans up.
Yeah, they're creating so much space for the Meepo, he's going to go out of control now.
He already has Blink now if he wants it.
Just Ravage and Fisher makes him able to do whatever he wants in teamfights. So, having a Meepo DPSing your whole team is very not good for yourself.
Yeah, now he's got the Blink Dagger, so he can be even more mobile and all over the map. We'll see what his next item is going to be, whether he wants to maybe sell these treads, get boots of travel. Probably not, because you want the stat sharing if you go for the Ags. Maybe until late game. I think, what do you think, Heart is probably the next best item for him? Or a Scotty? Maybe even a Sheep, honestly.
I don't think he should go hard. I think he doesn't really need that right now because he has those heroes tanking in front of him and the teamfight control, but he could go for another aggressive item like a Scotty or a Sheep, as you said, in order to get free kills.
Yeah, and as we look at Meepo, a pretty micro-intensive hero, but only one of the Meepos can actually use items besides the boots, and blinking onto the one-roll Spectre, bringing him down. Spectre face drums, doesn't have a lot. A hero that's going to be in Dota 2 eventually, Arc Warden. Okay, they won't let me talk about Arc Warden apparently. Nice disruptor ult there to get rid of that Shackle Channeling, going to keep Enchantress alive. Fisher, 2 second cooldown, net off the mark, but forces Xander to run north, and then it gets blinked on by Toy, and Toy gets the kill. Anyways, and a double damage on a Meepo. This could be like a game-ending push, honestly, at 16 minutes with double damage Meepo.
I feel like they have no answer for the Meepo now. He's just way too farm.
Yep, this is pretty much how the Meepo game went for Revenge when they ran it as well. Just kind of got out of control. Attack. They couldn't really bring him down, and it's a pretty hard gank because once he's level 3, he's got arguably one of the best escapes in the game. Just poof out to your other Meepo as long as you can micromanage two units.
Is this a best of 2 or best of 3?
Yeah, just 2 game series is the wording that we like to use in JDL. I don't really know why we shy away from saying BO2, but...
The Spectre is just going drums since he's behind, but I don't think that's going to help him anymore. He needs that Radiance, or he needs some game-changing item. The drums won't help him to get back from that deficit.
Yeah, the Radiance is obviously way better, because Spectre as a carry has no flash farming capabilities, which sucks, and that's where Radiance is really nice. Also, it works pretty good with her ult, I would say. But as terms of being a right-clicker, Phase Drum Manta is pretty good, so I think that's your backup plan, maybe, Phase Drum Manta, into a Diffusal, potentially. But again, obviously, it is not as good as getting a Radiance on time. But not going to happen this game.
Looks like there's a smoke gang going on bottom. If they can manage to pick off the Viper before he gets away with the mech, that could be good. They could get a tower out of it too. So that's a potential really good move from Dire's side.
Yeah, so far the Dire actually have not even managed to get one tower, and they've lost all their tier 1, so they're down 3 towers right now. That means Shadow Shaman has a blink up, Tidehunter has a blink up, already an Oblivion staff as he's working towards a refresher, and Vestius has just got enough money to purchase up his blink, so 3 blinks, 4 blinks, because Toy has had his for a while, already up to another 1,000 gold. Honestly, blink's pretty good on Viper. I will not be surprised if he goes Axe Blink.
The double damage has been activated. Is he gonna go ahead and use it against the whole team? Looks like they're going back. Not gonna utilize that smoke. The Meepo. I didn't know that the double damage was sharing on Meepos.
Yeah, it goes to all the Meepos. It's
that's
like
crazy.
Utterly ridiculous. That's why I was saying it could honestly be a game-ending push when he picked it up.
Even if it was just one, it's still dangerous. But now all of them, it's crazy.
Yeah, what that sweet fanatic said. This could be dangerous. Angel, he's there, but Meepo's got a double damage. He could just stand and fight. He kind of has to because he's not getting out of the kinetic field. He will go down. Benjaz almost. That was 1v4, and he almost killed both cores, the Centaur and the Spectre. And there was even a mech used from Razor to keep everyone alive. So that shows you how strong this Meepo is right now. And a support, unlike any other support, who can just split push lanes by himself, even though he's not by himself this time, they're taking down that bottom tier too.
That was a nice pickup for them. The gold from the streak went to the Spectre, so it's gonna give him a little boost. So maybe they can do something with it, but at this point, I think they're too far behind to hang on.
Wow, Disruptor should be so glad that he did not glimpse that Tidehunter back, because he would have ravaged, and the team is down here from the south. The Fisher's there onto Xander. There you go, Enchant Totem, Home Run Derby style. Glimpsing back. The Earth Shaker, it's not going to matter too much. One more slow attack, and now Meeple's going to come in onto the Shackle, landing the net as well, 15-6, 20 minutes in. Two pickoffs there in the mid lane, Ravage still online, Echo Slam still online, looking to push into another tower, or go for the Roche, because you don't even need the Serpent Wards when you've got a Meepo.
Shadow Shaman just picked up a gem, that's going to give him the whole map control they can use right now, so no more wards for Dire side, which is going to be really hard because they don't have towers. So they won't see that coming, which was done already. Are they going to fight this?
I think they might. Ravage, it's going to actually hit 3 in the end, actually make it 4 on the edges of that, but nice Static Storm goes out, Angel jumps right into it, will bring down 2, but there's a beautiful Fissure, and honestly, I think Meepo with an Aegis wouldn't be too scared to just fight into that after most things were used.
I think he missed flicked, because he ported to the wrong Meepo, which led him right into the Roche pit while his team was getting murdered.
Yeah, so that is one drawback of Meepo. Making one mistake like that can basically just lose your team an entire team fight, because you're pretty much relying on the Meepo to really kill anybody, and the other ones are just, the other abilities are just holding people in place. So if Meepo doesn't show up, then you get in trouble, like Tidehunter goes down there and the Shadow Shaman drops, but they still hold on to the Aegis, and now they can push in to the tier 2s, probably just go mid and go top and take them both out. Ag's done on
Viper
Nellis,
doesn't
on the
give
Viper.
A shit about the other team.
Yeah, he really doesn't. He's probably just banking on the other team's so scared that everyone's behind him that they won't go, and it seems to be working. Because honestly, they weren't right behind him until right now, and wow, big poof in from Meepo. He gets to get everybody. He gets the Razor, gets the Disruptor, now working on Angel, who goes for a Blade Mail first. I kind of disagree with that. I think he should have got a pipe. He goes down.
And he used his Blade Mail right after stunning, which doesn't make sense, because...
Yeah, it doesn't do anything. It's just like panic.
...in the deck.
Yeah. Radiance bottom tower. That is true. I was thinking return damage as well, but then again, he's not attacking. But so blade mail obviously makes sense on the hero; it's very good. But I don't think in this case. I think a pipe for your whole team would have been better as opposed to a blade mail for yourself. And again, these Fissures, blink and echo slam. Oh my gosh, the filth from Vestius. That was a really nice combo there. Mech gonna keep everyone alive as this disruptor does not have an ag, so they could still go ahead and use items in that. Static Storm. Something stuck in my throat. Jericho goes down. Someone was glimpsed away, but it didn't really matter. Another Fissure goes out from Vestius. Centaur going to look to counter-initiate on this, trying to kill Vestius. Will miss the stun, but that was a pretty much a ranged attack double-edge, and messes up the combo a little bit there, but still landing the nets. Anchor Smash goes out. Another net to land here. Now Lelis here with his Aghanim Scepter. Gonna, just wait for him to die in the poison. Helpless, trapped in the net, like a caged animal, the Centaur. But he is half man, so...
Yeah, this is pretty much game over now.
Xander's gonna call it.
There you go. Well, it was a nice attempt to do some original draft from both sides, I guess. Was interesting, but unfortunately they got ganked too much by the support rotation of Shadow Shaman and Earthshaker. Really, I guess.
Yeah, which I guess you got to expect. That's kind of what that combo wants to do. And Meepo was also 12-1-7, so really no answer to Meepo in the mid lane, no answer to Meepo in the mid game. And the support rotations came up big here for the houses down. That's game one of two here in the Join Dota League Season 3 America's Premier Division. I'm Helium, with me was Static Dota. You can follow us on Twitter, you see him down there in the bottom right, at Heliumbrella, at Static Dota, and of course his organization at Armada Gaming on Twitter or Facebook, and we'll be back with Game 2 in just a little bit.
See ya.
So, peace.